In this part of the course, I want to talk about how container storage works within Docker. Understanding storage is critical to be able to use Docker containers in an effective way. It avoids data loss and will help you make sure containers run as you expect them to. Now let's dive in and get started. The first type of storage available within a container is something I've mentioned earlier in the course, and that's the writable layer. As a reminder, let's say that you have a Docker image which consists of three layers. Conceptually, this would be represented as a single file system. When you run a container, a writable layer is added to this, and this uses the union file system. The result is that you see all of the existing data from all file system layers in the image, and then any new data is stored within this writable layer. And this includes both data which is overwritten as well as any new data. Now, the union file system allows files and directories from different file systems to be overlaid into one conceptual single file system. And this is what allows this writable layer to be added over the read-only layers of the Docker image. This writable layer is what makes every container its own unique thing. This architecture requires a file system driver, and this has overhead and can impact performance, so you have to keep that in mind when architecting containerized applications. Now, the key things to remember are layers from the Docker image can be read from, but any writes go into this writable layer, and the container sees both of these components as one single file system. Additionally, this writable layer is linked to the lifecycle of the container. It's not something which can be migrated around, so any data written conceptually is part of that one single container. Now, let's look at the other options that we have available. Let's focus for now on a single Docker host, and running on this Docker host, let's say that we have two containers. Now, the first storage option that we have available is TMPFS or TempFS. This is a file system which is accessible to a specific container which uses memory in the Docker host. And simply put, you should view this as fast in-memory storage, but it's not persistent because it's not being stored on disk. Also, it can't be shared between containers. So really, you should only use this for temporary storage, so maybe sensitive files which you don't want to be stored on disk for any length of time. So data that you're only holding for the short term while processing or accessing. The next type of storage is called a bind mount. In addition to the containers running on the Docker host, we also have the host's file system. Here we have the root, then inside that, folders called temp, SRV, and some others. The names don't matter. Bind mounts allow you to take a folder on the host file system, say /SRV, and mount this inside containers. And one folder on the host file system can be accessed by multiple containers on the same host. Now, this is a good type of storage if you need to share access to data which is stored on the host, but that benefit does introduce a negative. It means that this type of storage, and so any containers that rely on this, they also rely on a certain structure existing on the host, and this can reduce portability. In this example, a container configured with a bind mount will only work if the /SRV folder exists, and it might not if I want to run this container on my local machine or your machine, for example. Bind mounts, because they exist as folders outside of the container, they will live on past the lifetime of that container. And the folders they use on the host could themselves be network-based folders, for example, mounted remotely using NFS or the network file system. Now lastly, we have volumes, and these are like bind mounts in that they are storage accessible to a container, but they're managed by Docker, so the volume is created by Docker as required, and they also exist outside of the lifecycle of a container, so they can remain when the container which used them is removed. They can be moved between containers and even attached to multiple containers, though there's no file locking, so you have to be really careful about multiple processors on multiple containers accessing files at the same time. Now that's all of the theory around storage which I wanted to cover at this fundamental level. Don't worry, you'll get the chance to experience this in a practical way elsewhere in the course. For now, that's everything on this topic. When you're ready, go ahead and move on to the next part of the course.